There's a new movie out, well, a new trailer for the Eternals. The Eternals are weird characters and have always been weird characters. And even in comparison to something like Guardians of the Galaxy, never made a big impact. And there is kind of a reason for that. Let's explore the Eternals and why they kind of never were a big thing. I guess I should share what I thought about the Eternals trailer, and I'm just going to be honest here. Look, if you like the Eternals trailer for the scenery, how beautiful it looked, being the most unique Marvel movie, cool. You do you. I am not here to ruin your parade. I am here to tell you why I'm not interested in the trailer, and I'm just going to tell you why. I could not tell who any of the characters were. See, the big issue I have with the trailer at the end of the day is mostly because it's not characters. It's mostly lore about how they were not in the world with somebody narrating over it and watching over. And we don't know who the characters are. They're just there. Take Guardians of the Galaxy. The Guardians trailer is so much better. And I'm just going to tell you why. It actually kind of informs you on who each of the characters are. You know who Star-Lord is.
Who?
Well, Star-Lord, man. Legendary outlaw.
Drax? Sure, he's this big meathead who fights.
Drax, a.k.a. the Destroyer. Since his wife and family were killed, he's been on a rampage across the galaxy in his search for vengeance.
Rocket and Groot, these cute sidekick characters.
Rocket, wanted on over 50 charges of vehicular theft and escape from lockup.
What the hell?
Groot, he's been traveling recently as Rocket's personal houseplant / muscle.
Gamora, badass chick.
Gamora, soldier, assassin, wanted on over a dozen counts of murder.
From the Eternals trailer, what dynamics do you have? One guy's funny at the end.
I could lead them.
That's the joke.
Other than that, it's like, you were never meant to interfere with humanity, and now we must. What does that tell me anything? That you guys were just lazy assholes who were like, hey, Thanos. Time to, we're not gonna help with this guy, sorry. This is not a big enough threat. We're much more important than your half the world. What the fuck were you doing? At the very least, there could have been a way to write around this. Believe it or not, there actually are some comics that do write around this aspect about the characters. But let's be talking here. The trailer I didn't think was good. It's a very pretty trailer at times, but no substance to me. Now, if you found substance in it, cool. I didn't. With superheroes especially, I want to know who the characters are. And the Eternals always kind of had this problem. Even in the original comics. Let's go into some history. But I'm also just going to be honest with the Eternals. I wasn't into it from the moment I saw the costumes. Because I was kind of getting Fantastic vibes.
How did we get this far? Human beings had an immeasurable desire to discover, to invent, to build.
We have watched, unguided. We have helped them progress, and seen them accomplish wonders.
The wonder, the wonder!
And the trailer, I should also mention, is desaturated. I don't know what it is, but for some reason, Jack Kirby's colorful world is, like, in dark shadows, and I'm like, why the fuck is everything so bleak? It looks like everything is overcast in the trailer for the most part. There are some scenes where they have a little more color, but most of the scenes are, like, rainy or just not very colorful or washed out. Meanwhile, if you look at any Jack Kirby piece, like, just type in Jack Kirby into a Google search bar, and you're probably going to find more images with color than most from his crackling and stuff. Here's the thing. Eternals is a Jack Kirby book, and no movie has really done Kirby. There have been attempts. Believe it or not, the He-Man movie, the live-action one from the 80s, was a Kirby homage at points, despite its issues. But my god, I'm like, you know what? Yeah, frick yeah, this feels like Kirby. You know, Skeletor is a bit of Doctor Doom and Darkseid. It's great. Okay, the movie's kind of cheesy, and there's this whole thing about them being stuck on Earth, but not everything's perfect. I'll take what I can get. One of the big problems with Fan4Stick when it came out was that it really denied what the property was about. To focus on body horror, accidents of science, misfits, when Fantastic Four at its core is an exploratory superhero story about going into alternate dimensions and being a family. Body horror is not something that's really part of the Fantastic Four. Now you can argue the thing, but that's one of the big problems of the movie. It's not really the Fantastic Four. And I'm kind of getting everything but Jack Kirby from The Eternals. And I will say, The Eternals is not considered one of his high points. We're going to have to talk about the New Gods and explore them and their relationship to The Eternals. So let's talk about Jack Kirby. Jack Kirby is one of the most important American comic book creators. I really don't need to say much. And the history of him is kind of hard to do because there is a lot to talk about. From creator's rights, his relationship to Stan Lee, his influence on the American comic scene. It's way too huge, and this is only going to be a small part of his huge ocean of work. The Eternals was 19 issues he did, and one annual. And he created it after he stopped working at DC Comics. You see, there was a period of time when DC actually hired him over. You see, Marvel was the big dog at the time. They were popular, heavy. Guys, you don't know how much Marvel has dominated the market, really. They became the face of what people thought of comics. And in this case, with Kirby's work, they hired him over to get a little bit of that magic. I know it seems weird, but that's what they did. So, when they did it, he worked on a project called The Fourth World. Now, it was spearheaded by four titles. Superman's pal Jimmy Olsen, The Forever People, Mr. Miracle, and The New Gods. And together, they form kind of a collective mini-universe within the DC Comics pantheon. It introduced Darkseid, New Genesis and New Gods, Mr. Miracle, and all sorts of concepts that are still heavily used by DC today. It wasn't the only titles he created for DC, though. There's also his Demon series, O-Mac, and probably the longest lasting of these titles, Kamandi, The Last Boy on Earth. It's really good. But that's Jack Kirby's work at DC, and eventually he fell out with DC, went back to Marvel for work, and so he created The Eternals. And a lot of people figure that The Eternals is basically just him trying to finish out New Gods ideas, or just experiment with what he likes. Because, honestly, they're very similar concepts at times. There are these secret, like, godlike beings who interfere with the modern world and have been around for a long time. With the New Gods, was kind of like this. Mythology as science fiction, or science fiction as mythology. again, they were kind of treat new gods are kind of treated as aliens. Meanwhile, the Eternals are kind of more based on ancient aliens' ideas of these beings who guided humanity along its path. You see, the Eternals were created by guys called the Celestials. And were like, yo, we're going to seed planets for mysterious reasons. Woo, we're giants. We're kind of like Galactus. And they seeded them and created the Eternals and Deviants. And the Eternals are the good guys. The Deviants are kind of like the evil army type thing. A lot of that. And these two forces kind of coexist together, guiding and helping humanity along or denying them, challenging them. Again, that's kind of the general idea of the Eternals. And so you're introduced to this concept, and it's 19 issues of this concept. And I'm just going to tell you something about the Eternals comic right now. Every issue basically almost feels self-contained and also contains a different cast. One of the big problems with the Eternals is that while it has characters who move from issue to issue, and you'll see multiple, like, nobody has, like, one-offs appearances in the Eternals. But take Icarus, who's Icarus, or Icarus. Again, a long story there. He's kind of the poster boy for the Eternals, or the main dude. You'll often see him in a tiny little box on the original Eternals comics. That guy's not in every issue. Like, out of all of them, I think he has like 5 appearances at best. I could be wrong on that one. I haven't really looked at it in a while. But again, he's not in every issue is the point. Then you also have guys like Mercury, who's Mercury, like, okay, one of the other ideas is that these guys were actually the real gods. Now, you might be like, wait, this takes place in the Marvel Universe. Aren't the gods real? Yes. One of the problems of the Eternals was that it was hard to decide whether they would actually be part of the Marvel Universe or not. At one point, it was kind of like the idea was they weren't. Then they were. Because, I'm going to be honest here with Marvel Comics, Marvel tends to make series part of the Marvel Universe for one reason. It helps them sell. Like, I'm not even kidding. Non-Marvel Universe titles don't tend to do well, and this is just a historical fact. It's been true since the 70s, the 60s, and further beyond. Setting something in the Marvel Universe is more of an advantage to a comic than isn't. And it kind of pays out. There's only really one comic I can think of that avoided the issue almost entirely, and that's G.I. Joe and Transformers. And those are weird examples with their own little history in that. But my point being, it's very unusual for Marvel Comics to actually not publish something that isn't in the Marvel Universe in some way. Even Conan the Barbarian has been integrated into Marvel Universe and Hith mythology. Like, I'm not even kidding. Like, monsters from Conan actually exist without him in the Marvel Universe. So again, if you want a title to sell, put it in the MU. Put it in 616. That's just what you do. So now we have these guys who are gods, who were not the actual gods. Like, Juris is a stand-in for Zeus, except Zeus actually exists within Marvel. So there's like two guys who are Zeus. Mercury exists. Circe. Yeah, like the Greek pantheon is a thing within Marvel. So it's kind of this bit confusing thing a bit about it. So you kind of just have to assume that the Eternals were kind of there and the gods were also kind of there. And they kind of interacted every now and then. It's weird. It's not perfect. Honestly, the MCU seems like it's trying to streamline some of this with some of the rumors going about. Yeah, it's a little complicated. And it's a hard sell. The thing that everybody liked about the Eternals were the Celestials themselves. The Celestials are these cool, enigmatic creatures who are space gods. They're the higher level beings of this universe, and they form a lot of the basis of deep Marvel lore. See, the thing that's still like about the Eternals is Jack Kirby's artwork. It's colorful, it's grand, it's big. And that's one of the reasons why I'm not into the trailer. It just does not capture that majesty that's in the comic. It's like all these, like, boring people talking and they're not punching each other. That's one of the reasons why Jack Kirby comics are cool. They're not just like, hey, I'm a stiff dude making grand statements. You'll get people who punch each other. It's action. It moves, kind of. It's like he makes good poses. And now you have all these people like, mysterious, not loud and bombastic, not out there. It feels so lame compared to the comic. And that's one of the reasons why I like Kirby's style. It's out there. It's huge. It's crackly. It's colorful. And that's one of the things the Eternal comic does very well. Like Ajax, if you look at his costume compared to the movie, it's like, oh wow, Mr. Boring Spandex. Even Icarus' costume, which is probably the one with the least changes, is just like, yo, Spandex man, we're a Super Sentai team now. And, you know, they have all these details, all these different colors. Like, it's so nothing compared to the comics. And that's kind of one of the things. I want to see more Kirby on the big screen. I don't want to be, like, inspired by other shit from movies. Oh, look, we're this... Like, if you look at the redesign of the Celestials for the movie, and there are images out there of them, compared to Jack Kirby's, they're like these spindly alien things. And I'm like, oh, wow. I haven't seen that before. And to me, it's like you're just trying to make them into something else. And not like the artistic vision of Kirby. And it's like, ugh. Because, look, not a lot of movies do Kirby at all. And Kirby came up with such wonderful ideas in the comic. Like there's Carcass and the Reject. One is a deviant who's like, yo, I'm actually a well-behaved deviant with a soul of a poet. And then you got, like, the Reject, who's like, I'm a deviant, but I look like an Eternal. I'm crazy. Together they fight crime. They only appear in, like, two issues, but they're literally the best part of the comic. You have a Devil Train. A fucking Devil Train. Who makes a Devil Train? I want to see a Devil Train. Like, you have so much art to work with. It's beautiful stuff. And this movie refuses to use it. Oh, look at all this natural light. Like, okay, look, I appreciate natural lighting with characters and stuff like that. Natural shots, all that jazz. But the Eternals are really not the team to showcase that. Because the truth is, Jack Kirby kind of is one of those things you tailor-make for a special effects extravaganza, as much as I hate to say that. He's not a character... He's not subtle. He's not, like, oh, you know, we have to be, like, natural worlds. No, it's all about those alien worlds, those alien places, those grandiose palaces and stuff. Meanwhile, it's just like, what do I get from the movie? Oh, your spaceship is a giant table slab. You might as well have just made it the monolith from 2001 A Space Odyssey. And Jack Kirby worked on 2001 A Space Odyssey. Yeah, he actually did the comic. Who knew, right? It's just so boring. But one of the things about the Eternals that everyone comes back to is the deep lore of them. Because, believe it or not, the Eternals do actually have major appearances in the Marvel Universe. For one thing, Makari. Speedy Gonzalez dude. The Flash dude. he was actually put into Quasar. Quasar's a really good title, and the secret to Quasar as a comic. Now, guys, I'm going to tell you a dark secret about Quasar. It's a DC comic set within the Marvel Universe. It's about Clark Kent, who becomes Green Lantern, and he fights crime. And space forces. Look, I'm trying to sum up a 70-issue run of a comic here. Cut me some slack. It's good, though. I would actually check it out. I actually really dig Quasar. It has one of the best torture scenes I've ever seen in comics. I know that sounds bad, but it's really good. Either way, Quasar is good. Cersei became a member of the Avengers, actually, and got a huge romantic subplot with Black Knight. I'm going to point out that in the 90s, Black Knight was the only man who was like, you want to know what I'm going to wear over my chainmail costume? A leather jacket. He's something. But, and they had these multiple appearances, and they've been rebooted. Neil Gaiman's reboot is probably one of the primary inspirations, but it did a smart thing that a lot of people, that this movie didn't do. You see, the Eternals had their memories locked, and they had to reawaken themselves again to come out into the world. So, why didn't they just adapt that plot? Because then you actually have an explanation for why they didn't do anything during the Infinity War stuff, and now just don't look like giant assholes. Either way, there are good concepts in the Eternals. I would actually check out the original 19-issue run. You get Icarus, Mercury. I would check out their appearances in Avengers, Quasar, and the like. All good stuff. And possibly interesting stuff. But every series of the Eternals has been canceled. It's never been a comic that ever lasted long. And honestly, New Gods is better. It is just better. But there are some interesting ideas to take. For one thing, one of the reasons they're probably using the Eternals, and I'm just going to tell you why, is they're probably planning on trying to adapt Earth-X. What's Earth-X? Well, I'm going to have to sum it up. In the future, the Marvel Universe gets fucked. And everyone has powers on the Earth now, and there's a big mystery on why. Okay, so I'm just going to sum up. You see, this is kind of where one of the reasons why people talk about the Eternals. The big twist of Earth-X is that the Earth is a celestial egg. You see, the Celestials do this to make more of their numbers and reproduce. So the superpowered people of the Earth are meant to protect the celestial egg. And that's why superpowers exist on Marvel. And the new gods and the gods from like Thor places, there also were species like this who grew so powerful they became kind of shapeless and molded themselves based on legends around and stuff like that. This is deep and very weird Marvel lore. But a lot of people remember it because it's kind of interesting. It's very dark. The idea of Earth-X was to kind of try and create an ending to the Marvel Universe that tied everything up. So it kind of did that. And it kind of contradicts a lot of stuff that was established later and after. But that's what it did. And that's kind of one of the reasons why I think the Eternals are being used. But like I said, the Eternals are kind of a weird concept, and I hope this summary kind of makes you understand why they didn't exactly catch on, in my opinion. Like, they're very... Because the comic didn't focus on a core cast of characters, it was very hard to get a sense of them. It was a big, expansive world, but there was not enough room to focus on characters you liked. And this movie seems to be following in that tradition, which is probably one of the worst things you could do. With this movie, we really needed to have personalities established. And I think the Eternals do have personalities. But we need to see them. We need to actually start caring about them as characters. And not just deep Marvel lore. I want to like the Eternals. I really do, and I do, on an extent. I want to actually like the movie, but if I'm going to be honest, the big problem with it is that I just don't see them as characters. I see them as more just exposition dump lore people. And I hate feeling that. I hope that we get more of a sense of them. But from the first trailer, I just didn't. Like, the fact is, we don't even know most of their names from the trailer. Like, if you're just a person who don't know these characters, you just know these guys as, like, the blue Eternal, the green Eternal, the red Eternal. They might as well be Power Rangers. And I hate saying that about Power Rangers, because I actually do like that series. But, come on. Anyway, I would check out the comics, as always. But remember, one big problem with this team is that the characters don't get a lot of time in the spotlight. And that really blows with the Eternals. Because there are interesting ideas, but if you don't have any characters with those ideas, then it's just a bunch of noise.